So 2025 is a huge year for the environmental agenda. And we are doing a series of talks. And what an honor it is that you are the inaugural person with whom I have the great honor and privilege to speaking, our Deputy Secretary General of the United Nations, Ms. Amina Mohammed. What a pleasure it is to have you here in beautiful Nairobi. You have many, many things on your agenda, we know, but one of the things that is also under your big umbrella is the whole environmental dimension of sustainable development. And we have seen a lot of attention being paid to critical minerals in the energy transition. Why is this important and why now?
Well, first of all, congratulations, because last year was also busy for environment, and there were many things that you did that have helped us to really think about the ambition and how we're going to shape this year. Critical minerals, I mean, last year we looked at the conversation and the discourse around exploitation of critical minerals, given the energy transitions that we all engaged with, given that we were going to be looking to see how critical minerals would play its role in technology, in particular the use of AI, which was moving in leaps and bounds, and suddenly we were talking about data centers, and we were talking about all sorts of things that were going to impact the environment. But also, you know, not really having any guardrails around critical minerals, the next big exploitation. Mm-hmm. And is it one for the opportunities that we see in our green transitions and energy transitions? Or is it going to be not for not so good, where there is no visibility, horrible things happen in the dark, and the exploitation becomes history repeating itself.
Right.
And so for that reason, putting together a whole bunch of experts that the SG has a report that comes out of did two important things for why it's important. Set the principles around which we want to see the exploitation for the benefit of mankind with the context of environment in place. And get five recommendations that we got out of this to say, how do we go about doing this?
Right.
So I think it's, you know, let us take the opportunity of critical minerals. Right now, we see China and we see DRC and we see Chile, but there will be many more countries
Indeed.
That will be exploited for this. Can we get ahead of it?
Mm-hmm.
And can we make sure that the environment and people are safer because of it and not so?
Well, this is so great what you're saying, and we were very pleased that the Secretary General and yourselves established this panel and moved it forward in the way that you did. And for us, you know, we think about, we can't have the old colonial extractive patterns repeat themselves. So how do we have value add? And of course, how do we ensure that people don't abandon things and that leaves environmental scars? And of course, this whole take, make and waste, how do we get circularity? So this is what we will bring to the agenda. And we look forward and hope that UNEA will look at this issue. The UNEA has been quite seized with mining, and so we'll see what they ask us to do on this topic.
Well, Inga, the recommendations which cover three of the things that you've just talked about also include that we have to do right and justice by the people, indigenous people, people who are in these environments that will be exploited, and we need to put a fund to put guardrails around that, to invest in them, the knowledge that they know what it is their rights are and how they can engage with government and with the private sector that will come in. I think we also need to understand it's more than just the environment, because the environment in which critical minerals are being exploited are also the context of conflict. And so when you say we're addressing so many things, there will be a conflict, and somewhere there is part of that root cause is the exploitations of minerals. And so I hope that we can also see this as addressing the prevention of conflicts, and that there are, you know, good, safe market solutions to this, and the value addition, the traceability, the circularity that you talked about are all addressed.
Wonderful. I want to ask you another issue, because another big meeting that's going to be happening is in Brazil. Our Brazilian friends have put up their hand and say, we will host this very critical COP, COP 30, in Belém, in beautiful Brazil. And so what is it that we, the United Nations, and frankly, we, the world, should be focusing on? We know that there are these promises that we give each other every 5 years, these national determined contributions. What do we need to see in them, and What is it that you would like to see happen in Belém? Mm-hmm.
Well, I mean, we're coming off the back of the global stocktake that said to us, now we have to have NDCs, our plans for, you know, the climate crisis, environment, biodiversity. But it did say this needs to be sector-wide. Mm-hmm. This needs to be economy-wide. That's so much more difficult to do than what we've ever had to do. But we also had the conference in Baku, which promised the resources to try to make that happen. Mm-hmm. So when we land in Belém, can we ensure that we have an understanding and what is reflected in the NDCs are about the economy, industrialization, everything that we need to invest in is going green if it hasn't gone. If it's new to us, can we start with green, blue, turquoise, as we know? Can we align the resources for that? Because no one's going to come to the table with an NDC that is sector-wide, that has to have a very serious macroeconomic perspective to it, if we're not going to see the resources. Right. So that $300 billion that we got in Baku, can we take it over the trillion to Belém? So it will be another opportunity for us to lean in on the 1.5-degree world that we want. The UN system, and you've been anchoring much of that, has said, well, look, we're going to look at 35 countries, which represent just over 80% of the emissions. If we get sector-wide NDCs in those countries alone, we will have gone further down the road.
Precisely.
But we can't leave the others behind.
No.
And so we will encourage them to come along. So Belém will be another opportunity for us to get it right. And we keep below the bar, and we need to just, you know, edge this much higher for the ambition. We're in a very difficult world right now, and I think we need to show what can be done through the NDCs and how it can be an agenda of, as you've always told me, the triple planetary crisis. We have talked about climate action, but that is development, that is adaptation,
Absolutely.
That is looking at biodiversity, that is the pollution. And unless we see that, we will be speaking way above the heads of those who have to implement, take the policy decisions, bring the money.
I mean, for us, of course, this milestone is absolutely critical. We will, as always, be issuing our emissions gap report, our adaptation gap report. But we will also showcase, I mean, we're speaking in Kenya, where more than 90% of electricity is renewable. There are solutions, and they are the job creators, and they are the growth engines. And so this is what you always said, that it is a development dimension. As we close out, let me just ask you this, and I'm sure you get asked this all the time. But as you look at the complexity that you just referred to now in the political environment, and yet you soldier on, you have this energy that just keeps going. So what gives you hope? What gives you the ability to get up in the morning and just continue soldiering on?
Beyond the chocolate, I eat. Okay, what is it that will happen in this world if we don't do it? It's the number of people and the environments that we will lose. Mm. And I can see that in my country every day. I grew up in Lake Chad. We used to go across on the hovercraft in the 60s. Today, that's not possible. And so I can see the damage to the environment around me. It will worsen. And that damage means worse for people, for women, for children. So the implications of inaction, the implications of not keeping up the energy to get past the cynics, to get past the deniers, to get past those who've got lots of inertia, and to find those who have the same mindset and to gather that momentum to move ahead. We've just come out of meetings on the food systems. It's a big deal for smart agriculture to be understood better and invested in where the environment is in consideration. It's a big deal that nutrition happens not with us just thinking that we've got only a livestock agenda. We have much bigger agenda for us to have nutritious meals in schools. So it's the can-do that gets me up. And there is an awful lot. We've never had so much in our hands to do stuff than today. And so why should we fail?
Ms. Amina Mohammed, Deputy Secretary General of the United Nations, thank you for coming to Kenya. Thank you for this conversation.
Thank you for having me and the work that you do.
Thank you.